So good afternoon, everyone, and we welcome all the officers for the second half of the day. So as we discussed in the morning, we have completed those two sessions like internet and information security fundamentals, and like we also done the like data protection and browser safe uses of browser kind of thing. And now in this session, like we are talk about social engineering attacks, and in the last session we are also going to have a discussion on the social networking aspects there. Like we are going to discuss something about like WhatsApp security, FB security, and those aspects we are going to discuss the privacy and security aspects. And in this particular session, social engineering attacks, madam is going to cover like various social engineering attacks at individual level, at organizational level, and how do you take care of yourself for during these attacks kind of thing. So let me give a brief introduction about Professor Valli Kumar Imam. So Dr. Valli Kumar Imam, she is a professor at Andhra University with over 26 years of experience in teaching and research, and she holds a PhD computer science PhD degree in computer science and systems engineering with a specialization in network security. And she also received a gold medal for her best research. And she researches on data analytics, data security, privacy, and threat intelligence. And she is a principal co-investigator of the Cyber Security and Data Analytics Center sponsored by the Information Security Education Awareness Project by Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, Government of India. And madam was also vice chairperson of AP State Council for Higher Education. Her commendable achievements were automation of the state common entrance examinations, CET examinations, and a development of software for start a new degree colleges, new courses, and a collection of asset data of colleges in the state, data analysis and decision making. And madam is also director of AI Computer Center. She developed this software for examination division, which is catered to the needs of 700 affiliated colleges of Andhra University in 2013, using open source technologies and skilling around 30 students in-house. The software impacted more than 50 lakh students so far, and established the first of its kind data center in the campus, and still it is in use. And she was a founder chairperson of IT section and founder HOD of the CSE Department of UU College of Engineering, a woman, and member of AP State Knowledge Mission, and several committees of AP and Orissa governments, like Task Force Committee to Inspect the Engineering Colleges, Staff Selection Committees, member of a Ministerial Delegation for AP Private Universities Establishment Act, and the Preparation of Innovation Policy for Education Institutions in AP and National Board for Accreditation for engineering colleges, and madam's and University Grants Commission and AICT. And she has more than 30 plus awarded with the PhDs under her guidance, and she has published more than 150 repeated papers in repeated journals and conferences. And she has conducted several conferences, workshops, student mega events, innovation fair, and hackathons. She is a senior member of IEEE, fellow of IET, and life member of CRSI, CSI, ISTA. So with this brief introduction, I request Professor Valli Kumar Imam continue the session on social engineering attacks. Thank you, ma'am, for joining with us for today's session.
Thank you, sir. So good afternoon, everyone. I'm pleased to deliver the lecture on social engineering attacks for the ISCA community. So in this afternoon's talk, we'll be briefly going through certain concepts of social engineering attacks, how the attackers perform the attacks, what are the technologies behind, and to some extent, a brief extent. And we'll also go through demos of a couple of attacks which are performed under the scope of social engineering. Well, as you can see, so this is a cyber threat real-time map of Kaspersky. Hope all of you know about Kaspersky antivirus software. So it's their website which projects the present attacks that are happening across the globe. So it's a real-time map. Now, going directly into phishing. So because phishing is one form of social engineering attack. So phishing attacks, they're all about sending false emails and links that appear to come from legitimate sources. And these sources look very close to genuine sources with minor differences. What is phishing? So the victims, they are tricked into revealing out their very sensitive information, something related to their bank accounts or their personal information. Normally, phishing attacks, they are carried out to know the passwords or account numbers, credit card, debit card related information, the pins, and so on. And this data directly goes to attacker's database. And you may be surprised to know that phishing as a service is now quickly picking up. So you must have heard about clouds as a service, cloud related services. So infrastructure as a service, software as a service, and so on. But now phishing as a service is now available. There are certain software kits related to phishing that are being sold, that are being developed. Okay, so people, they buy licenses to perform phishing using these softwares. It's quite amazing to know phishing economy is now getting industrialized. According to a recent report, which is published just a month ago from Akamai. So they have studied some data in 2020, the last year, Jan to December. And they have observed financial services experienced tens of millions of credential stuffing attacks each day, remember, in 2020, which peaked at 63 million in November. Okay, so credential abuse means your login names, passwords, they're being collected. The PIN related data is being collected. Okay, so we'll see how these credentials are carried away in this talk. Mostly phishing, which I have just told you, is sent through an email or an SMS. How is phishing carried out? It's not just the email, but through the email or through the SMS, they send you some malicious software. In most of the cases, what does the malicious software or the malware do? It does whatever was told by the attacker. What can it do? So it can encrypt your data and demand ransom, demand money for decrypting it, or sending you the password through which you can decrypt. That is one. Or it can irritate you with lot of advertisements when you visit a website. So that is, again, it could be because of the malware. And also, it can get installed in your computer or your device. and can record your keystrokes. Can record your keystrokes in the sense whatever key you are pressing, the key code is collected and then is formed as a string of characters. And then that string is sent to the attacker's machine, or it is stored in the attacker's database. And it can also steal your credentials, like your username and password. Now, as I told you, how does it come to your computer? There are many ways through which it can get into your computer or your mobile device. It can be downloaded from a web page. So if the web page that you have visited is already infected with malware, or the web page that you have visited is genuinely written by somebody only for the purpose of pushing a malware, or when you click on an email attachment, it gets downloaded into your system, or when you inject a USB into your system, and that USB was also used elsewhere in a system which was infected with malware. So if that USB, you put it in your system, it may spread to your system too. Sometimes CD, which is already infected with malware, okay, when you just push into your CD drive, it automatically plays, and in the process, some program may get into your system. And normally, we download lots of software. Many people download lots of softwares, or lots of songs, or movies, or okay, software in the sense pirated software, or cracked versions of software. You may be using some application like Torrent, but then somebody who posted that cracked version of the software, or that movie, or that song, might have attached some program, malicious program along with it. So the torrent-like application might be good, but the file that you're downloading may be an infected one. So along with it may come the, along with it, the malware might come. Using cracked versions of softwares, so people leave a lot of doors open for attackers and other programs to come and stay in your system. So that is the reason why people say, ask us to update our softwares whenever a fix is required. How do you know there is malware in your system? There might be increased CPU usage. Means when you double click on a particular icon on the desktop, it may load very slowly. Okay, CPU is busy executing certain other applications. And system may hang and may not respond to any mouse click or the command. And sometimes you may suddenly see some strange icons appearing on the desktop. Or certain folders may have some strange files which you have not created. And there might be some encrypted files. You may click on that icon, but nothing really opens up. Or certain files might have been deleted. So what are these malwares? How do they look like? So the typical names that people have given to these malicious programs are viruses. Most of you must be knowing this term called virus. Malicious program, which can replicate itself. But it has to attach itself to various files or programs based on the user activity. It cannot run by itself. So that is why it's called as a virus. And so it makes use of other programs to run, to be precise. So that is a virus and is a malware. Then we have what are called as worms. So these are also computer programs which can self-replicate. So virus attaches itself to another file, but bomb, it can self-replicate. And it mostly uses the network to spread itself without the use for network activity. So it may actually consume a lot of computer resources, but destructively. So you must have seen a lot of power plants, I mean, power grids, and a few organizations that got affected, like the, it's a worm called Stuxnet. Okay, so that has already infected many organizations. Trojan horse. So Trojan horse, it's something like hiding in a horse and crossing the border. So it looks legitimate by appearance, or you know, the way it gets installed, but can take control of your computer. It can damage, disrupt, it can steal information or do any harmful action on the data and the networks. So then we have what are called as remote access trojans too. Okay. What do these malicious software do? They deliberately execute whatever the attacker has made them for. And usually those attackers have harmful intent. They write it with an objective of doing some harm to the target system or the victim. So normally all these malwares, they can encrypt your data, they can ask for ransom, as I told you. Okay, so then what else? We have adware. What is adware? You must have seen certain advertisements automatically appearing when you download some applications into your devices. So whenever you try to open a Word file or some other file using that application, an advertisement pops up. Okay, that is advertisement related software, adware. Then logic bombs, they execute exactly at a particular point of time. Then ransomwares. Okay, people demand ransom through these programs, through these softwares. So you must have heard about WannaCry. Okay, and many more ransomwares are circulating across the internet. There are spywares, the spy related softwares which get installed in your computer and carry away lots of information. Could be your camera data, could be your mic data, could be your Word files, could be anything. Then keyloggers. So whenever you type something, they log those key press events and then construct these strings and then carry them over to the attacker. Okay, backdoors. So these are something like they get installed in your computer and open a permanent window to another computer to talk to your computer. So these things, like for example, when you consider this adware or these kinds of softwares, they actually monitor your behavior. They gather a lot of information about what you do. They give you a lot of pop-ups when you visit those websites. Okay, they also track which websites you're visiting. Right? Okay. So whatever, all these malicious softwares, they collect a lot of information and then they carry away that information to whichever destination they were written for. So the only counter is to use antivirus softwares. Well, most of the antiviruses, they do good job. Only thing is, it may take a few hours for them to update the virus signatures. Whenever a virus or a worm or a malicious software is detected, its virus, its signature is actually updated, and all the packages they update so that when such a kind of a malware again comes into the system, that signature is compared and is dropped or you are alerted. Now that you know malware comes into your system, either through a phishing mail or through an SMS or when you visit some website, how do you know that a malware exists in your system? How do you check a file has got malware? How do you check whether a website that you have visited has malware? There are many ways, but I would like to show you simple one which you can also use. This is a website called virustotal.com. And what does this do? You can actually make use of this search button and then type the URL of the website that you are suspecting, or type the IP address of that machine that you are suspecting, or type the domain name, or type the hash code of any file that you suspect to have been infected. Like for example, let me see the URL. So this is something which we already tested. So this is having malware. Let us see how this virus total detects it. Yeah. Yes. So Fortinet, scumware.org, they have identified this to be phishing website and it is supposed to have malware. Similarly, there are two more vendors who have declared it to be malware and spam. So there are many, like Kaspersky says this is clean. So these are all different softwares again, or vendors who actually detect the malwares. Okay, a few of them say it is malware, a few of them may not. So that means not all vendors have got their programs perfectly well. So if you are really very, very suspicious, you have to, you know, refer to two or three softwares. Similarly, you can actually check for more details on what it is about. So webmail, email spam, and okay. So its serving address is this, and look at the SHA code. So this has a unique signature. This is the malware signature. This is the unique ID, like our fingerprint or, you know, our face. So a system can detect this particular software using this unique ID. And you have lots of other data, okay? So I can actually come back and then just, instead of the URL, I can check it through just its signature also. Right? So like this, any file that you suspect, you can just type its URL or upload that file into VirusTotal or search by its signature. Let me show you something. Say social drop. Again, said to be a phishing website. Okay, sir. So this is how you check whether a given file or a website or a virus signature or a unique ID rather, it is related to malware or not. What is the impact of this malware? If it gets into an individual system or it gets into an enterprise system, an organization network. Let us see a few attacks that have happened through these malwares. So 2013 Singapore cyber attacks. This cyber attack was by the hacktivist organization called Anonymous. It was done partly in response to web censorship regulations in Singapore. What was the regulation about? Websites with at least 50,000 unique visitors from Singapore every month that publish at least one local news article per week over a period of 2 months will have to remove prohibited content, such as articles that undermine racial or religious harmony within 24 hours of being notified by Singapore's media regulator. So to be precise, it says that if websites publish something and if government says it is prohibited content, you remove that article, these websites will have to remove that article. That is what it says. And against this, the group called Anonymous, they have brought down a few websites. And they posted a video in YouTube with this mask that you see on my right side. Okay, and said, and they threatened to bring out a few, bring down a few more websites of the government. Next is the Sony Pictures hack. So again, a group called Guardians of Peace, they leaked the release of confidential data of the film studio Sony Pictures. What is that confidential data about? It is about their families, employees' details, emails between employees, information about salaries, copies of unreleased Sony films, then scripts and plans of future Sony films, and lots of other information. And not just carrying away the data, they also deployed a malware, which is a variant of Shamoon Viper. That's the name of the malicious software. So they employed it to erase the servers of the Sony system. And why did they have done this? It was because Sony was about to release a film called The Interview. And it was a plot to assassinate North Korean leader. And so this team, they threatened terrorist attacks at cinemas screening the film, and many US film theaters chose not to screen. And Sony also canceled their formal premiere and mainstream releases, and they released the digital version. Then the LinkedIn hack. So in 2012, 6.5 million user accounts were stolen by Russian cyber criminals. And again, in May 2016, an additional 100 million email addresses were put on sale. So you can see the news report, list of user IDs and passwords allegedly sourced from cyber attack in 2012. put on sale for around very small amount, right? As the site says it is taking action. Even after 4 years after the attack, they still had lots of data which they were selling on the web, dark web. Yeah, and there was a retail store, so target mall. So 2013 holiday data breach and cyber attack, what it means is for 1 month altogether in a holiday season, people were shopping in this chain of stores, and for 1 month, the credit card data that was, you know, swiped by the customers, it was carried away because somehow the attackers gained access to this retailer's network. So what was the impact? 100 million individuals were exposed in the attack. 100 million individuals' data. And the next very popular attack is the DIN cyber attack. This was a series of DDoS attacks. So they were targeting the DNS provider called DIN. You know, DNS, when you type a URL name, it has to get the machine address. Because by name, the packet cannot be routed through the internet to reach the server. So it has to be converted to some machine address. So such a provider was DIN, and that was hacked. Okay, so what happened? Now any website ID, which was actually hosted by this DIN, which was serviced by this DIN, it was rerouted to a different place. So the requests of users never were serviced because they did not reach the actual servers. So the distributed denial of service attack was accomplished through numerous DNS lookup requests from tens of millions of IP addresses, right? And as you can see, these were some of the companies whose services got affected because of this DIN attack. You can see all the majors here, Amazon.com, BBC, CNN, and so on. The Netflix email scam. So more than 110 million Netflix subscribers, they received an email. Okay, and when people opened that email, so they were asked to feed some credit card details, and the attackers, they have succeeded in stealing people's credit card details. Just imagine 110 million people getting an email, and even 1 million of them, if they respond, okay, even half a million of them respond, the attacker's job is done. He's successful. Next. This is about the WannaCry ransomware, and it affected 99 countries in almost no time. And there are reports in the media that 75,000 ransomware attacks were found, and many might have not been reported. So this was spread by taking advantage of a Windows vulnerability. Okay, later on, a security patch was released, but people who didn't update, okay, even now, they're still at risk. Other notable breaches, we know Aadhaar breach, Aadhaar data breach, many times it was published in the media. Then Facebook, Quora, Marriott Hotels, Ticketfly, British Airways, Cathay Pacific, and many more. Just recently, a couple of months ago, so we saw this in the news, 40 Telangana substations attacked by Chinese malware. And then Ukraine power cut was a cyber attack. So this was again, the blackout lasted over an hour and started just before the midnight on 17th December. And it has affected 2,25,000. Okay, so see the impact of the attack. Lakhs of people, they're impacted if the power goes down. Lots of companies, lots of organizations, they get affected. And then recently, Maharashtra Cyber Cell submits report on Mumbai power outage, confirms malware attack hit power grid. Okay, so this is also the Ukraine malware kind of a thing, the Stuxnet. Then even stock exchanges have severe cyber attacks. Okay. In Feb this year, so phishing attack targets Indian officials through rogue email from government ID. So somebody's mail ID was dormant, maybe the officer got retired or it was not in use. So from that mail ID, many mails were sent to other very top officials. Okay, now if some attachment goes via the email or a form goes via an email, then there is a huge impact, right? So NIC, our National Informatics Center, it issued an alert soon after the attack. So, and after COVID-19 started, okay, the number of malicious domains that started getting registered increased, malwares, ransomwares got increased, phishing scams and frauds increased, lot of fake news started circulating. And till then, people were actually saying, look, you got a lottery, or I'm held up in South Africa, and so all the, you know, please send me money and this is my bank account. These were the kinds of emails people were getting till then. But after COVID-19 lockdown and all, and work from home and all these things started, the theme was somehow circulating around COVID-19. So these emails and SMS messages were often impersonating government and health authorities. Okay, somehow they make victims to enter the personal data. Maybe it could be related to vaccine or Aadhaar or things of that sort. So it was found that a lot of data harvesting malware, which was trying to take away login and passwords, were being deployed, like rats or spyware, Trojans, they were on the rise. And mostly people were focusing on stealing data or diverting money. And lot of malicious domains, the website names were getting registered around Corona or COVID. A lot of fake news was spreading across. Every single day, hundreds of messages are being generated and put into circulation. So hackers have not even left the vaccine making companies. So people have targeted even the vaccine making company, as you've seen the headline here. So this was, again, people said this is a Chinese hacking group called APT-10, also known as Stone Panda. So they have somehow found vulnerabilities in the supply chain software of the vaccine making institute. Now, at a given point of time, say, I want to show you the real time thing. So this is what is happening as of now. You can see the time below. Our time zone is different, but you can see this is the source and destination of the attacks that are happening at the current time. Top three attack origins, top three attack targets, top attack types. Okay, and these are the IP addresses and so on. Yes, and so this is the Kaspersky one. This is the real time map. So you can see the origin and the destination. So you can see country. So from here, the attacks are happening more. So how do they plot these maps? This is the Fortinet one. So these are all the people who make antivirus softwares or who make network devices. So they can actually detect the signatures of programs and they can learn the traffic pattern, as you can see here. So this tells you the attack, the severity, and the location. So you can see from which place to which place the network traffic with malicious softwares is flowing. So just imagine, in a few seconds, we are able to see so many packets flowing. Just imagine the whole of the day. What is the scenario? And this is just related to Fortinet findings. And people might be deploying a lot of other makes of devices also. So you have seen that phishing is one way of performing social engineering attack. And normally, malicious softwares are somehow downloaded into your machine by luring you or tempting you to click on a link or a website or tempting you to download a song or a file or a photo, or making a phone call. Okay, so generally you are being rushed or you are asked to bypass procedures. So certain websites, they may ask you to give permissions to, you know, write their files onto your drive, maybe in the form of cookies. Or when you download some mobile applications, they may ask you for even a Word like document application. So even those things may ask you for camera access. Okay, even a temperature application, it may ask you for your mic access or contact book access and so on. So all these applications normally want to bypass procedures. So the same way, social engineering, which involves humans, okay, they try to push you forward by passing the common normal rules and procedures. So they'll be very curious to know more and more details, sensitive details about your finances or your personal data. And they may often use some confusing jargon and message sounds too good to be true. So something like, so we are giving you a credit limit of so much, so you just provide us with the details. Or we are giving you something for free, so you want a car, so deposit the base amount, and because we have some procedures and norms. So message sounds too good to be true. For 1 lakh deposit, he may say, I'm giving you 1 crore in return. So stop talking in that case. stop responding to the emails, disconnect, and then contact any concerned officer of your organization if the device belongs to the organization. Social engineering, it's an organized process, and they have thoroughly established goals. They study the requirements. They do a lot of research. They do a lot of recon or reconnaissance, and they analyze and then they attack. So based on their findings, even if they fail, they have already gathered a lot of information. Now they may replan an attack. Gathering information, how do they do? So very simple, Google is a good information provider. Like we people search it for certain kinds of information, but attackers search, use the same Google for searching a lot of other information about the target company, its infrastructure, or the individual target. So you can simply, type this in a particular website. You want to find out, say, all the people who have Gmail account. Okay, so you can just type this kind of a thing. You can make use of Google Hacking Database. So there you can search for, you have certain commands. Because we are running out of time, I'm not demonstrating you because I have other things to show you. But these are some of the things wherein certain WhatsApp dumps, even the WhatsApp files of certain users, they are on the internet. Okay, camera dumps are there. Lot of username and password lists are there in Google. So Google Hacking Database, if you visit, you can find lots of information like this. Then showdown.io. And there are many other websites also, wherein you can also see cameras, CCTVs, which are linked to internet. You can see the output of the camera from your laptop screen. Okay, showdown.io is one such website. Yeah, a patient search on Google actually reveals out a lot of other CCTV cameras in the balconies of the house or on the streets or in organizations, certain factories. That is because people don't set passwords or they leave out default passwords when installing those cameras. So if you can search for, open cameras on the Google, you can see many places from Delhi or Vijayawada or, Hyderabad, many, many small shops and many offices, banks, cameras hooked onto the internet and clearly showing what is happening in that office. Yeah, there are a lot of security breaches, and these breaches, the data that is collected is also posted on the internet. So whoever is trying to perform a social engineering attack, when he's trying to gather information, he need not just go through Google or Showdown or things of that sort, but he has databases themselves. So this is a data breach search engine. Like Google is a search engine for us, the websites, data, which has been breached, that data is available here. Well, is this legal? Will be the question that comes into your mind first. They have posted that also. Once a site has been hacked and the database is in the hands of a number of individuals not related to the hack, it is considered public information. And as researchers, we are allowed to distribute and allow users to search for their information according to a number of Supreme Court rulings. So they say anyway website is hacked, anyway data is out to many people, Then what is wrong in providing the same data to a few more people? They'll be doing these search. Similarly, the person whose data is breached or the organization whose data is breached, they will also know that this is the scenario. So they can correct them. That's what they say. So what is NSBase and how does it work? It indexes information from websites that have been hacked and had their databases leaked. So we allow our users to search for emails, names and usernames, IP addresses, phones, hashes or even passwords so that they can find out if their information has been leaked. And then there is this for individuals. So if you have registered with some website for a service, normally when you want to log in, you register with any portal, right? If that portal is breached, then your email ID is also with somebody, right? Your email is part of that database of that website. So you can check whether such email IDs that you provided to other companies' websites, if they are breached. Okay, you can type your email or phone number with which you have registered with that service and then click on this spam and you'll get a lot of information, right? And so there is something called dhash.com. So again, you can search for a lot of compromised resources. So any identity leak, it can be found here. And then there is something called, I didn't type the name properly. So there is something called ghostproject.com. Even this gives a lot of information. Okay, next. Attackers can harvest even more information through already attacked websites. So if some website is already attacked and defaced, it is posted in joanh.com. So you can just visit that and see as of now, this moment, what are the websites hacked? Okay, every few seconds, minutes, the defaced websites, their URLs, and the first page is actually displayed out here. There is another tool software called HTTrack, which people can actually dump the whole website of any organization into their computer. So they can analyze all the links, all the pages, right? They can also do it online, but one option is they can download the whole website into their system. So that is about collecting information, gathering intelligence, or reconnaissance as we call it. So how is social engineering carried out? We just learned email phishing, baiting means injecting a USB or CD, or through Wi-Fi phishing, you connect to a Wi-Fi access point in an airport or in an internet cafe or, you know, a restaurant or park. So connecting to a genuine access point is fine, but there might be some rogue Wi-Fi points which people intentionally install and give Wi-Fi free of cost. If people connect, all their passwords go in plain text. Then SMS phishing, QR codes can be faked. They may lead you to a wrong website, wrong in the sense, other website than you are thinking about. Or physically, somebody may come to you and say, I am coming from so-and-so servicing agency and want to update your software. Or they can sit at the system, get the root password, and then create another administrator account and quietly go off or install some backdoor program and go off so that when your system is up and running, any attacker's module can directly connect with the newly created admin account, which you are not aware of, and other people from outside can have access to your system. On phone call, somebody may call and say your debit card has expired, or we want to update details, we're calling from so and so call center, you kindly give us the data, or give an OTP, something of that sort. So a lot of frauds and scams might happen. So how do you get this SMS-ish, like phishing through SMS, how does it happen? There are a lot of services like this, lot of websites which offer these services for money. So what you can do here is spoof. So you can send a message like as though you are from some other, you're sending the message from some other phone number. You can select the spoofed number and then the recipient to whom the SMS has to go and date and time when it has to go. And yeah, if you have brought this service, put the license code here and then you can set, construct a message. Hi, your KYC is updated. You're getting a cashback of 1000 rupees. Click on this link. Now, when you click on this link, yeah, it is the attacker's web page and you know. You know the rest, what follows. So these are cloned pages. They look like a Facebook page or SBI page or some your office page itself or some very authenticated government page. But these are cloned pages. So you can watch them in the URL link. So you don't see a HTTPS. Look for HTTPS and a lock symbol here. If it is not, don't feed any details in that kind of a form. If you still have a doubt, you just put it in VirusTotal and check. If some pop-ups are coming, advertisements are getting displayed, if you get a doubt, put that link in the VirusTotal page. So what do the attackers do? They clone some popular website and they make you click on this and then they make you feed details into this. And these original email and passwords that you type, they don't go to Facebook, but will go to this attacker's web server. So he'll collect all the data and then he can log in with your username and password and change the thing, change your, so that you will not be able to access the account anymore. Yeah, there might be key loggers which may get installed, but only way to, you know, counter them is to install antivirus software so that you get alerts like this when malwares get installed in your computer. So this is for an alert for key logger software. There might be voice-based messages like this, for instance.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर, आपका नया आई सिक्योरिटी एटीएम कार्ड 2 दिन में आपके घर पे पहुंचाएगा। और एक बात सर, कृपया आप अपना डेबिट कार्ड नंबर और ओटीपी नंबर किसी से भी शेयर मत कीजिएगा। थैंक यू सर। हेलो सर, हम एसबीआई बैंक से बात कर रहे हैं।
क्यों सर, कदा ఎంత తెలుగు తగ్గితో హమారా బ్యాంక్
సర్ ఆప్కే ఏటీఎం కార్డ్ కే లాస్ట్ 8 నంబర్ కన్ఫర్మ్ కీజియే
5
హోప్ యు కుడ్ లిసన్ టు దిస్ యా విల్ గో టు ది నెక్స్ట్ వన్ సో హియర్ ఇస్ ఎ ప్రోగ్రామ్ దట్ ఐ క్విక్లీ డెమోన్స్ట్రేట్ ఇన్ 5 మినిట్స్ ఆన్ హౌ when you click on an SMS link, okay, that website actually that click of the link will download a malicious program into your mobile phone, and that malicious program can get connected to the attacker's machine, and the attacker can actually send instructions to your phone to send an SMS to somebody from your phone, or that attacker can carry away your camera feed, whatever output that the input that the camera is taking, or your mic data, or your call log dump or SMS dumps. He can collect literally everything. Whatever is in the phone is totally under his control. Okay, so my computer here is an attacker's machine, and the mobile phone over here into which the SMS is sent, that is a victim system. Okay, and we are establishing a connection by designing an ehacking.apk mobile application. So SMS will be sent so that when he clicks on it, this ehacking.apk gets downloaded into the mobile phone. Now, once the ehacking application is in the victim's phone, the next thing that happens is the attacker gets connected to the mobile application which is there in the victim's. So once you can see the attacker has full access of the phone. So this was just created, this environment was created in the local network. This actually can be performed in the general network internet. And this just for education purpose. We request people not to experiment otherwise. It's getting loaded. Is the mobile and the system are connected. Once the connection is established. So we can check information using the sysinfo command. You know it's Android now, the operating system. And you can list the commands. You can dump the call log, dump contacts, dump SMS, geolocate, send SMS, set the vibrant mode to ringer mode and ringer to vibrant. Do all these commands possible. So you can see we are dumping SMS call log and changing the ringer mode. So now we'll go back to the attacker's machine and check what data is collected from the phone. So we just, in order to save time in the lecture, we just recorded the whole process. So look, you have all the files in the attacker's machine. And you can see the messages, open the messages. You can see the call log dumps, who called on what. Okay. So this is. And there are a lot of other attacks also possible. So we'll quickly go through how credentials are carried away, login and passwords. So it's called the, let me share the system. I'll show it like. So we can actually clone the Facebook or, you know, any other website, Google or your company website or SBI or, you know, any company website, we can clone. So that means we can display a page exactly similar to some familiar popular website so that the user may not get a doubt. Can you see the screen, sir?
Yes, ma'am. It is black screen right now.
Oh, you want me to share this? Okay. Oh, just a second. I'm sharing this.
Yeah, we are checking, sir. Guru Shankar, sir, like we are checking. Kindly wait.
Now, sir.
No, we are not able to see any. No. Yeah, now we are able to see, ma'am.
Okay. There's a delay, I think. Okay. So, yeah, okay. This is my attacker machine. And so I'm trying to clone the Google page. Now, let me open our page. So this is the cloned page. Right, sir. So clone page means it looks exactly like the Google page, but you can notice it. This is not a valid page because the lock symbol is struck off, and that means this is not secure. Okay, connection not secure, and you should have google.com there and not any other name. Now, if I am typing something like june17talk@gmail.com and I'm typing the password 12345678 9 and I click on this. Now you see, I'm again getting a Google page and I'm getting a lock symbol now. So what does this mean? The previous page was a cloned page, attacker's page. So when I typed my credentials, okay, they went to the attacker, and attacker took those credentials and silently forwarded me to the actual Google page. Now I may think, okay, I have done something wrong, and then I may click on the Gmail account again, I may log in. But now what happens in the background? This is the attacker's machine. As you can see, june17talk@gmail.com and password 12345678 9. They have gone to the attacker. Now the same thing will happen for all the people who will click on that link. Okay, so this is nothing but a phishing attack. You click on a link and an application gets downloaded, and that application is fully under the control of an attacker. Or you click on a link and you get a page, Facebook page or Gmail page or your own company page or any banking page. You submit your credentials thinking that it is a genuine page, and those will be carried away by the attacker. And if that account is a highly privileged account, an admin account, he can actually get hold of whole of the company's website. So this is like the thing that people should really care about. So these are about different attacks, and normally most of the phishing attacks happen through emails. So never click on the attachments. Closely observe the subject line, okay, and notice from whom the mail has come and how many people are there in the CC. So if there are lots of people, then usually that means an attack. Okay, never click on the hyperlinks. And for any company to actually, withstand or have defense, so phishing is just one aspect of it, as you can see in the middle. Phishing is just one aspect of it. And you have a lot of other things, okay? But then phishing helps people in really impacting or carrying out attacks that impact the organizations like any. There are a lot of safety tips given in Google. Similarly, Facebook has got some privacy tips, and our infosecawareness.in website has got lot of information for all categories of people. So you may go through, you may ask your families to go through this. There are very small, very, very precisely written, so very in easy language, and will be helpful. Similarly, whenever your operating system asks for an update, please do update and don't delay it. Similarly, there is something called as Tuesday patch and Tuesday updates of Microsoft. It's a monthly cycle. So they release patches for vulnerabilities that they find. Okay, and you may update your softwares at regular intervals. There are a lot of antivirus softwares. You cannot really say this is good or that is good, but try to use at least one software in your personal computer. And if it is sensitive data in your office, try to use multiple protections, software level, hardware level, have firewalls and things of that sort. So thank you so much. With this, I would like to close.
Thank you, ma'am, for a wonderful session. And like questions, keep questions. So questions before we go to the next session. Of course, like there won't be any break kind of thing. We will go ahead because the time is limited. So yes, officers, if any questions, kindly, so that we will try to. Otherwise, thank you, ma'am. Of course, if any questions comes, I will ask you, ma'am.
Sir, sure.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
for your time as well as the session once again.
Thank you.
So I hope everyone is there. Thank you. Thank you, Guru Shankar. Of course, like this, going to class and security questions, and we are also introduced it to the e-learning assessment. Okay, so I request you also should give some responses when we are asking something. Then it is easy to move further. All right. Is it okay? If it is okay with you, please say yes in that area. To see as from everyone. I got some 2-3. I wanted at least 100 plus yes or no. Is everyone is there? All right. Yes, excellent. All right, thank you so much, sir and madam. Let's move on to the session. So this is a known topic for all of you, and we all know we are using this kind of things since from a longer this kind of thing which we are using from a longer period of time, right? So let's see what is the social networking. These are the some things which we are going to do, a small difference between social media and social networking. A social media is a one way, they will say something, and most of the times we will be able to respond to them, what are the TV and all kind of things. It is a one way. You can send them, and you may not if they ask anything we may respond in another, not a single platform kind of thing. What are the FBR etc. platforms which we are using? So this social media platforms and social media accounts, so whatever they share, we can you can listen them, or you can act accordingly kind of thing, but you may not be respond to them on the same account. Okay, see, that's the kind of thing. So for example, WhatsApp bot account and all that, there you will be able to maybe ask something, it will give you some kind of information. So those are bots. It is a mechanically or already fed information. So you ask something, and only that relevant information, if it is found something relevant, get that information. Otherwise, thank you, or maybe able to get kind of thing. Okay. So social media is a one-way communication, but whereas in a social networking communication, we can talk to each other. It is a one-way, bi-directional as well as multi-directional. Bi-directional in the sense two people can talk, and and more than two people also can talk and discuss or whatnot. All these kind of things we can do it by using these social media platforms. Okay, so what is the social networking? Social networking is a service online platform used to build social network relations with other people who are similar personal interest, career interest, activities, backgrounds, and so our purposes. So we do this working, which is highly commendable. You know, actually using all these things. You know, today my daughter is telling what she's telling. Now the schools are started, so they have to go to the school. So all these children and all those people are there saying bye bye. Of course, I don't have the teammates. There it seems they are saying bye bye for all the social media platforms. So that is the kind of thing. That is how we are acquainted. I mean to say, like, we are acquainted. More people are using, whether it is a senior citizen, young or a child, whoever it is, everyone using all these platforms. So that's only the reason we have to be more and more cautious. All right, so why do we use the social network platform? Use this platform to meet people online across the world. You may be in Jharkhand, Bihar, somewhere, and you also can interact with the people outside in you know, some other continents. Okay, so that's the social network. You can talk to them, friendships, make professional networks, and you can build your professional career. And all such kind of things can happen, and you also can build your profile and also self representation. See, earlier, like we all days with social networking platforms, you know, in one day you can become a celebrity. Is it true or not? Please say no, sir, in the chat area. In one day or 2 days or maximum 3 days, you will become a celebrity. Is it? Is the voice clear to everyone, sir, or only few people? It is not clear. Yes. If there are any network issues, it happens. Otherwise, I will try to speak. You know. Thank you. And you can also build your profile. You can do a self-representation. You can exchange, share the information related to the studies, education, and everything. So these are the one side of the social networking platform. So these are some of the advantages. You know, see, for example, one good thing is, you know, I seen, like, in recent times, if someone is affected or infected with any of these COVID kind of thing, and who are looking some kind of financial benefit. So started keeping that kind of requirement in their statuses, and the people are responding. They are getting some lakhs of good, lakhs of money. And if it is a genuine case, of course, like, we all should support. We have to check whether it is a genuine or not. How far it is a genuine, how far it is a fake kind of thing. Those things, you have to check it, and you can do it. At least, as of my, in recent times, we have supported behind such information number of cases. So that way also these platforms are useful. Same time, there are some disadvantages also. We will discuss, like, what are those disadvantages, and these are the different varieties of social platforms are there. Socializing, what are the platforms socializing, or Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, and all, and career and business opportunities, LinkedIn, Naukri, and all such kind of things, and online matchmaking and online shopping sites. We have listed out only few. There are so many things, there are so many apps which provide such kind of things. Okay, we have just listed a popular and maximum used things we were showcasing here. All right, morning, you have seen, like, in a given minute of time, how many number of transactions which are happening. You can just see, like, there are more than 283K spent online shopping in Amazon. These are some of the statistics. It is not that, like, by showing all these things, we don't want to create any kind of terror, or we cannot create any kind of ambiguity. But the only thing is, like, we all know, prevention is better than cure. Okay, as an organization, as an individual, we are not against any of the platforms or any of the against the technology. No, the technology, every day the technology is growing, and we are also growing, the people who are using the technology is also growing. But when we are using, we have to use it in an efficient and effective manner so that we can safeguard ourselves. So morning I have seen in one of the chart area, I think one of the RPF, like Railway Protection Constable officer, like who lost more than 20,000 rupees kind of thing. It happens. If you are not able to take care of ourselves when we are using the social media or social networking platforms, there are chances. There are chances that anything can happen at any point of time. Okay. So these are the number of a good amount of transactions which are happening in a given minute of time. There are so many such kind of things. And at the same time, if you see, these are the some of the cyber crimes which are reported in the last year, like in the April, May, June, July. You can see there is a terms of the cyber crimes are reported. The reason behind the spike in the cyber crimes are most of the people are under the lockdown. And there are so many who are start using the mobile time. Not internet fully. They got the device and start using. Whether a young or a young citizen or a senior citizen or a child, because of the COVID norms, people have started using all these things without full knowledge. So these cyber criminals are also using that as an opportunity to lure the people. So that is how it is reported. So you can just see there is a increase of 59% is online financial frauds. All right, online financial frauds, it is almost like 60%. Remaining 24% are related to the social media, like the one which we are talking about. It is not that, it is not a small number. It is a very, very big number, 24%. Okay, so where it is reported kind of thing. And if you can just see on the right side, new ways to cheat the things, we all know, it is a old wine in a new bottle kind of thing. The frauds are not new. The frauds are always remain same. But only thing is like they are using innovative ways. They're using the innovative approaches. See, now everyone is in need of COVID vaccination. So they're using that as a COVID vaccination. So you click on this link, you can register yourself so that you will get vaccinated. So there are so many such kind of things which are happening. I'll be showing some of these examples also, and job frauds, because of a good number of people lost their jobs in the pandemic. These frauds using, that is an opportunity for those people. And as I told you, new users of digital payment apps targeted with old methods like KYC, know your customer. They will say like your KYC documents are not updated, you update it. I think from last 1 week or so, I don't know like how many people SBI KYC is one, and SBI gifts is one on their anniversary kind of thing. And before last week, there was a huge amount of peculation in terms of the Tata is giving the anniversary gifts kind of thing. Did any of you have received those messages? Either SBI, can you please yes or no? Can you please say yes or no? Did anyone receive any such kinds? Either SBI, okay, yes, no, you are not received. Good, sir. Anyone else? Yes, all right. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you so much for your response. And SIMSWAP frauds and phishing links, just now we discussed, and fake government websites were also created in terms of, you will be getting all these benefits where the government has announced that, a lot of big schemes where everyone will get good amount of money and all such kind of things, government benefits. Okay. And fake PM CARES UPI IDs. So that was a danger. Like the PM CARES was announced in the 7 PM in the night. By next day morning, there are more than 8,000 fake UPI IDs were got created. Just imagine, in overnight, 1,000 fake UPI IDs were got created. By the time our NPCI, National Payment Corporation, they have identified and they put all these fake UPI IDs. But in the meantime, don't know how many got created kind of thing. See, in most of the phishing and vishing attacks or smishing attacks, so these try to create an unwanted ambiguity or unwanted emergency. They will say like, this offer is there only for next 2 to 3 hours. Unless and until if you do it with the next 2 to 3 hours, you might not get anything. Your card will be blocked, your account will be blocked, and all such kind of things will be created. So that, like whatever the phishing we were talking about, so the phishing websites or phishing links and all the things, it may not be there, you know, for days together. It will be there only hours together. Earlier, it was a scenario days together, but it is not that. Now the scenario is maximum number of people are using the phones, maximum number of people are using the internet, and the maximum people are also got cheated because of the emergency. They will just, you know, push up a message somewhere in the 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock in the night, and they will call. And you know, if you are not able to do these things in next 2 to 2 hours, 2 to 3 hours kind of thing, you will lose all your accounts. So like that, they will create an unwanted emergency, and the people are tempted to do that, and they will lose all their, you know, hard-earned money for these fraudsters. So these are the number of cyber crimes, and these are the type of cyber crimes which are reported. So keeping all these things, like, we have to be very careful so that we can safeguard our hard-earned money. And at the same time, we also safeguard our, you know, dignity, and like whatever the dignity and the name, fame, like whatever you have gained. If by any chance, if you have lost something, then there are always chances that anyone can lure or anyone can do anything at any point of time. Okay. So as I told you, like, there are more than 900 million Facebook users are there. 1/3 of the Facebook users are there in India. 100 million people uploaded in the Facebook. 450 million access are via mobile, and 150 million of are there in USA. And in India, more than 300 million Facebook users are there. Like that, like, there are more than 140 million Twitter users are there, and 175 million LinkedIn members over 200 countries. So these are the big things. And I think recently you also might have been heard about these phishing links. Domino's, Air India website was got hacked. Domino's thing was got hacked. And, you know, one more Whitehead Juniors. There, you know, hacked in the sense, like, you may not be losing anything. Like, whatever your data is there, like your name, mobile number, address, a credit card, a debit card details, like whatever you have used or whatever you have paid kind of thing, all that details, it will goes out of your hand, and it will be there in someone's hand, in some other hand. Okay, they will start misuse, or they, by using that, like, they may threaten you, like, they, these are the things which are available. Unless and until if you are not paying these things, you will lose your money, or, you know, such kind of blackmailing kind of things also happens in the social networking platforms. Okay, if you look into these, the social networking platforms, these are the things, you know, by knowingly or unknowingly, this is the kind of information which goes out of your hand. Your name, mobile number, email ID, birthday, photos, videos, all this kind of information, your location, your ISP provider, browser type, and all such kind of things. You may ask a question, like, if all this information goes out, what will happen? We will see some of the cases, okay? And if you are by any chance, if you are attaching any of the credit card, debit card details, those details also will go out, all right? So these are the kind of thing, you know, 88% of the people, name is available, and age details are available. And, you know, interestingly, 49% of the people's mobile numbers are available, and home telephone numbers are available, and bank account details. 7% of the people's, like, who are using these social media accounts, those people bank accounts are also available. So these are the some statistics which we got it from some of the websites, you know. So what will happen if you have such kind of information? It may lead, you know, these kind of social networking frauds or stigma kind of thing. It may lead to cyber stalking, social phishing, cyber bullying. Cyber bullying is nothing but, like, it is a kind of, you know, harassment by using the social networking platforms. So you are making a friendship, it is good, like, you and me are chatting, and we have exchanged a lot of messages, like, exchange a lot of videos, photographs, and all such kind of things. Till the terms are good, nothing is going to happen. Once the terms are bad, so these people will start misusing. These people may misuse, you know, any of your details kind of thing. It is not that everyone will do that. there are some, you know, fraudsters who will misuse. You might have been read, you know, in the social, in the log, there are so many people who made a friendship with these people, and they have collected all their photographs and all the things. They have morphed their photographs, and they have started blackmailing the people, which we have seen, you know, a number of cases. It is good that like nothing has happened to any of the people, many of the people. There are some people who have faced such kind of issues. Okay. And cyber stalking, it is a mental harassment kind of thing. And exploitation of the personal information and identity theft. Morning, we have discussed the identity theft and the personal information. If I have your email ID, mobile number, your photograph, I can create a fake profile on your behalf, and I can exploit all your contacts. Okay. How it will happen? We will see those things. And exposure to sexual content, blackmailing, illegal content, age inappropriate content, all these things can happen in these social networking things. You can just see, this is a classic example. Now, by saying all these things, we are not just to the social media platforms, but only thing is like we have to take the preventive measures. That is only the thing like which we are discussing in these you know, day long session thing. See, 32-year-old lady, you know, she's an unmarried, you know, we don't know like exactly it is an unmarried lady. She made a friendship with one of the person in the FB, and the relation was good. They have maintained this relation for some months together, and finally they decided like they wanted to get married, and they wanted to get married. That is a good thing. And he said like he came from UK. He said like he is a doctor at UK. And this lady is from Bangalore. That really was good. They have charted, and the charting is going on, and they decided they wanted to get married each other. And finally that person said like he's to India with lot of jewelry and all such kinds. He also wanted to settle down, so he wanted to India. That is what communicated to this lady. So this lady is also believed, and you know, he said like everything in the customs, unless and until if you pay the money, they won't release. So like that, like she initially she paid some 40,000. Later, you know, I think initially 15 lakhs. Later 18 lakhs. You know, something like that. Like somewhere other, she had paid more than 71 lakh rupees within 2 days. Within 2 days, she had paid, and he was keep on telling like this is the custom, this is GST, you know, import, what not, all such kind of things. He tried. And somehow she transferred more than 71,57,793 rupees, you know, within 2 days time. And finally she realized it like his profile was not there, his mobile number was not there, nothing was there. She realized, and she approached the police people, and they made a complaint kind of thing. You know, very less amount of money they're able to recover. So once money is going around, you know, to the fraudster, we don't know like where it is going. We don't know like whether the fraudsters is there in India or abroad. Okay. So these are, as we all know, internet has no boundaries. And the cyber crimes also has no boundaries. In similar way, like if some money was transferred from one account to other account, that account also has no boundaries. So within no time, they will transfer here and there kind of thing. Where all it is going also, we don't know. So that is how things will happen. So this is another thing which is happened. So those are the two angles, you know, who are cheated by the person. And not only those two angles, there are more than 200 people who got cheated. Later part they have realized. But only one good thing is like these two girls that came forward, made a, and they were trying to do, investigate the thing. Finally, police people have investigated something. They fought, they're able to catch that fraudster, and they're able to kept him behind the bars. Okay. So he said like in overnight to all his friends, like his mother was not doing well, he's hospitalized. And overnight he got 20 lakhs rupees. Later part he was stopped talking to these people and all the things. Then they went and made a complaint kind of thing. Then all these frauds are came out. So he's a 9th class boy who used, you know, her his classmate's photograph, you know, morphed photograph, and he started blackmailing that family, and finally he was caught and kept behind the bars kind of thing. Okay, so these are there are so many such kind of things which are reported here and there. You also might have been read all such kind of things in the you know, read in the newspaper kind of thing. So by saying all the things, it is not that like we don't want you to use the social media. You should continue to use the social media, but like what are the social media platforms are providing the social, you know, security and privacy? If you keep these security and privacy options on, then this kind of risks will be less. This kind of risk will be less. Okay, so let's see, like, because maximum people are using the WhatsApp, we will just see like what is the WhatsApp security and privacy. Is everyone ready to do along with me? I'll just tell you some of these security tips. Are everyone ready with me? Please say yes or no, then I will just discuss. Is everyone ready to do it? Whoever is there, all right, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Okay, ready with your devices. Okay, so the first thing, like, I'm going to discuss some 3 to 4 aspects. First aspect is how to safeguard your mobile data. Mobile data is also precious for some people. For some people, if you have unlimited mobile data, you can make it. Okay. So the first, you can just click on those three dots, and if you want to click on that, like, you will be getting the setting option. Under the settings, you will be getting all these account chart, you know, notification, data uses kind of thing. So click on the data uses. Once you click on the data uses, all these options will be there. While using the mobile data, you want to download photos, videos, kind of thing. So it is asking, if you want to keep, you can keep it. Otherwise, what we can suggest you is, if you have a good connectivity, either your office, if office permits, or at home, you can download all your, to download such kind of media, you can download over Wi-Fi rather than the mobile data. So if you click on Wi-Fi, you click on that vector to where all these options, then you check these options and you just click it. Okay. Then, like, whenever you come back or you came to a legitimate or a genuine Wi-Fi network, then all these things will be get downloaded. Okay. Like you can safeguard your data, mobile data, you can safeguard. Okay. So the next is, which is very, very important, the privacy in the accounts. In the first option is privacy. If everyone is able to reach this privacy option, you can just click on three dots, settings. First option is privacy. Did everyone able to reach the privacy? Please say yes or no. Did you able to reach privacy? Very good. Very good. Okay, click on the privacy. So once you click on the privacy, there are options. Last seen, profile photo. So those things are, you can just see that. So I'm just focusing only on the profile photo. Just click on the profile photo. By default, it is visible to everyone. By default, it is visible to everyone. So what we suggest is, we suggest you to either do my contacts or nobody. Okay. If you move to my contacts, the people, those who are, they can see your profile photo. The other people cannot see your photograph. And you know, if you choose nobody, nobody can see your photograph also. If at all, if you're keeping any profile photograph, no issues. If at all, if you are keeping a profile photograph kind of thing, so we request better to keep only my contacts rather than everyone. Or like, you can choose no one also, so that your photograph nobody can touch. Otherwise, if you leave it like that, your photograph can be taken by someone, and anyone can use such kind of things. Okay, you just select this only my contacts, so that will be one good option you can follow it up. Are you able to do that? I completed, sir or madam? Completed? Please say yes or no. All right, good. So the next option is under the privacy. You have seen the profile photo is the first option, and last option, you can just see print lock. You click on fingerprint lock. By default, it is disabled. If you enable that, no one can open your WhatsApp account. No one can open WhatsApp account. If you enable that, no one can open your WhatsApp account unless and until you provide the biometrics. Okay. That is the next privacy option, which is provided by the platform. And other option, this is very, very important. So we recommend this to avoid or misuse of your WhatsApp account thing. So again, as usual, click on settings and click on account. You are already seeing the privacy, you have seen the security. Now you see the two-step verification. Now you just see the two-step verification. You just click on the two-step verification, and in the right side screen, you can just see two-step verification screen. If you click, if you select and click on enable, okay, you will be getting this kind of screen, extreme left side screen you will be getting. There you can set your password. There you can set your password. If you set your password, and if you press on next, and you will be moving to the email, whether if you want to provide the email, you can provide, or you can just skip it. It is not mandatory. You can just either provide or skip. And final step, everything is done, you just click on done. If you just done everything, you click on done. So whenever you want to open a WhatsApp, you cannot open your WhatsApp. Unless and until you provide this kind of pin, like what are the pin you just set, if you provide that pin, then only you can open it. Otherwise, you cannot open the WhatsApp. Is it clear? Is everyone able to do that? Is everyone able to do it? All right. Good. Remaining people? Okay. Yeah, any other people? Any other? Or you wanted to go back? Just once again, you can just go to settings and click on the account and click on the two-step verification. Yes, very good. And two-step verification, click on enable, and later you can just provide the two-step verification pin. And email ID is not mandatory, it is optional. And once you just click on the done, so that whenever you want to open a WhatsApp account, you cannot, nobody can open your WhatsApp account. Okay, so these are the privacy and security options which are provided by WhatsApp. So then make use of those so that you will get benefit out of those aspects. Okay, is it clear? Thanks, many people have done that. Thank you so much. There is one more option which is available in the WhatsApp. People, we all will face these issues, like whenever you go to a group, the moment you click on the any video or any image kind of thing in the particular WhatsApp group, if you click or if you download, immediately it will come and store in your storage area. Okay, to avoid that phone storage area, all the things to getting downloaded, so here is an option. You need not to download everything, each and everything onto your phone's memory, so that you've got your phone memory, and all this is not getting downloaded in time, you can also safeguard your mobile device. Okay, so to do that, like what are the things we have to do that? Like this is applicable only to the group. This is applicable only to the group, not for the individual accounts. Okay. So you just select any group. You just select any group and click on group info. The moment you click on the group info, you will be getting these options. The third option is media visibility. So if you click on the media visibility, by default is yes. In the right side extreme screen, you can just see. So by default, like whatever you are clicking or whatever whenever you're clicking something, immediately the data will be downloaded. To avoid that, by default setting is messages will be get downloaded, and it occupies a lot of memory. To avoid that, instead of default thing, you just select no, so media won't be downloaded into your phone memory. Media won't be downloaded into the phone memory, but all the media, like what are the media receiving, it will be remains in the group. Okay, only thing is, like, it won't get downloaded, so that you can safeguard your phone memory. Okay, do that. Did anyone perform this step? Please say yes or no, sir. All right, thank you. So this is the some of the privacy and security settings which are provided by the WhatsApp. You can enable and you can use your accounts. If at all, if you are not choosing any of these security settings kind of thing, I think each and everyone will get this kind of messages. By spending some 10 to 30 minutes, you can earn up to 3,000 rupees. And if at all, if you want to earn anything between 500,000 rupees, you can call this number. Or like you are one this account manager country, whether the account manager Karupati is there or not, you will be receiving all these things with or without season. You will be receiving these kind of, and people will start cheating these things. As I do, if at all you chosen, nobody here in this particular city, photo, and if you are chosen nobody, no one can add into their WhatsApp group without your permission. If at all if you are chosen that nobody, no one can add into their WhatsApp, into their WhatsApp account, without your permission. If at all those people wanted to add into their WhatsApp group, you will get a notification. See, Jagdish wanted to add group. Are you willing to join or not? If you only will join the group, if you are not willing, you won't be join the group. That option also available. If at all, if you are chosen the nobody in the profile photograph area. Okay, so that's the advantage you will get. Okay, you want me to repeat, sir? Okay, I think this part you have done right. Profile photo, you can just go to the settings, and you can go to the privacy, and you can just see that profile photo. And if you choose nobody, no one can add. If you choose there no one, challenge from everyone to my contact or nobody. Okay, if you choose here nobody, no one can add into their WhatsApp group without your permission. Okay, you choose this nobody. Is it clear? Is it clear, sir? Shall we move? Okay. So these are the some WhatsApp privacy security aspects kind of thing. So why are we too much giving stress on the photographs? For example, all right. So ISDF photograph is there. I have uploaded this photograph in this website, tinei.com. So see, I just wanted to check how many people using my photograph are using this ISDF. So I just uploaded this. I have seen more than 10 people are using. So that the cloud, APK cloud and all tech world, these people are using my ISEA logo. Similarly, you can find out if anyone using your photographs for any purpose without your permission or without your knowledge. Okay, you can use this tinei.com so that you will come to know who are using using your photographs. Our logo and whatever it is, anything you can find out by using this. So these people will crawl the entire internet and they will throw the results. So this many number of people are using kind of thing. Okay, one thing you can just see, I have uploaded my photograph under the website map.com. There is a website called pic2map.com. You just upload your photograph into that pic2map.com. You just see how much of information it is giving. Okay, it is giving what is the camera you have used, what is the date, what is the address, what is the city, and top of all those things. And it is also, you can in the right side, you can just see where your house is located or where you have taken the photograph, where you have taken the photographs. So this much of information goes out of your hand. If at all any of your photographs are available, any of social media platforms. Okay, so we all know one picture used to talk about some thousand words of information, but the same thing is applicable in the digital world also. So photographs we are uploading in any of the social media or social networking platforms kind of thing, if any of the visitors can download photographs, and they can find out. So this much of information, okay? They can find out longitude, latitude, house address, and all such kind of. So based on all these things, they will create a kind of profile accordingly. They will try to target and try to get user. Okay. Once those people are having your photograph, your address, and all these things, so based on that, they will just create a profile kind of thing, and they will try to blackmail the people. Yes, I have your photos, I have your videos, and they will tell all such kind of things, whether it is there or not. They will blackmail by using all such kind of things, and they also tell you like this is where you are residing, or this is the place where you have visited, all such kind of things. They will try to blackmail. So what we should do is, so our sincere suggestion to all of you is, it's not that like we are not suggesting to not to upload photographs. You can upload the photographs, upload limited number of photographs, or provide a limited limited information in any of your social media platforms, so that you can safeguard yourself. And especially young women and young girls, whenever you are uploading the photographs, be careful. Don't upload your individual images. Try to upload only the group photos in the low resolution. Okay, try to upload photos rather than individual photos, and try to upload low resolution images, the full resolution images, and limit your postings in the networking. So why we are telling all these things? So what is low resolution? We all know if any of your mobile cameras, now all the cameras are 64 ml, 128 pixel, all such kind of things, that kind of high resolution pictures we are getting on our mobile, through our mobile phone, and we have started uploading or started using all this information into the, if you are uploading low resolution images kind of thing, someone want to download and can find out the details also, they cannot do anything. Group photo, it may be a bit difficult to morph such kind of images. But nowadays in the new operating system, whatever the Android operating system or iOS operating system, so they were also telling when you're taking the photograph, they're also telling like, do you wanted to capture the geolocation or not? Okay, they're also telling you whether you want to capture the geolocation or not. If you choose not to capture the geolocation, it won't capture, so that no information will go out of your hand. Okay, I hope I'm clear. The reason why we are focusing and telling like not for social media thing, so these are the reasons. Am I clear? Please say yes or no. Okay. All right. So this is with respect to the WhatsApp. Do you also want to see the Facebook? You also can set all privacy and security options. Okay. I'll just show. Lightly, I'll just show it to you. If he's using the FB accounts or not, can you please say yes, sir? If good number of are using FB, then we will discuss. Otherwise, we won't discuss. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Then I'll just show you. Okay. Some people are not using. It's not a issue at all. Okay, I'll just show you so that at least you can just do those settings after your once you go back. Okay. So what I have done is, I opened this account. I just showing you. Do it later, but don't do it now. Drop down arrow, then you will be getting these settings and privacy options. You just click the settings option. Okay, once you click on the settings option, in the right side, like you will be getting all these settings. So our Gmail account and all these accounts is visible. Because it is a business account, like we just kept it open so that people can contact us for any of these things. you know, in the second option, if you click on the security and login, okay, as I told you, these social media people are capturing all our details, like which is the PC you are using, what is the location, and all these details they are capturing. If you want to know more information, you can just click, or you can click here so that you get to know like more information. What is the system? What is the mobile phone you are using? What is the operating system? What are the area you are using? All this kind of information you will get to know here. Okay, what is IP address? You can just see what is IP address. What is IP address here? What is IP address here? So all these things they will try to capture. So click here, and if it is not required, click here, log out, so that the information won't be stored. Change your password, save your info login, and you have also two-factor authentication. I just shown you the two-factor authentication in the WhatsApp. Similarly, you also can keep two-factor authentication for the FB, so that you can safeguard your FB accounts. Okay, so these are the things, and your Facebook information also there. See, nowadays these people are also capturing your off Facebook activity. You can just see here off Facebook activity. If you click on this off Facebook activity, like what are the websites you have visited, what are the transactions you have done, all the details they're capturing. Okay, unless if you disable the options, they will come to know like what are the things you are doing, what are the apps you have used, what are the apps you have opened, what are the transactions. You can just see. So these are the some things, you know, they are capturing all my details. Okay, so they're capturing like what are the websites I have visited, what are the things I have done. So all this information I have removed, but otherwise a lot of things are there. Okay, so the information, whether you use the Facebook or not, if the Facebook account, if you are not logged out properly, and what are the things you are doing, all this information is available with these guys. And to avoid all such kind of things, click history, and you can set your things so that they won't capture your off Facebook activity. You also can just go and see like what was off Facebook activity, and these people, this is how they will try to capture all your information. Okay, and you can just back, and there is a privacy options also. So these privacy options I suggest and request everyone, so please, privacy options, you have to set these things. Especially these things you have to keep it. Okay, who can send the friend request? Is everyone or limited people? Who give a friend list? So this is very, very dangerous. So this is what I'm telling. So who can see your friend list? Why I should open my friend list to everyone? Why I should open my friend list to everyone? There is no such kind of requirement. I will open my friends list only to my friends or only me. If you ask it, the friend list is only with me. If I open the friend list, you and everyone knows like who are my friends. There is no need of showcase my friend list to everyone. Okay, so please keep it only me or only friends. Okay, within the friends. We will kept it public because it is a public account. Okay, similarly, you can just see who can look up the using the email address, like what are the email address and phone number you have provided. You can also set who all can see, only friends, or like you can reset yourself, okay, to none also. Everyone, friends, only me. You can choose accordingly. So if you choose only me or only friends, and if you kept this two-factor authentication, if you kept these privacy settings, and if you switch off your Facebook, off Facebook activity kind of thing, you can safeguard your Facebook activity. Otherwise, there are always chances that anything can happen at any point of time. If at all, if you are very high profile people, so they will target only high profile people only to capture the details, and you know, to lure the people, to blackmail the people. Okay. So the two-factor authentication is nothing but you can just go to security and login. You can just go to the security and login, and there is an option called two-factor authentication. Okay, you just click on the two-factor authentication. You can just see like you want to authenticate through app, or like you wanted to get a text message. If you set this text message, if you click on this, then they will be asking you a mobile number. You have to provide your mobile number. So I have to provide my password. Then they will ask you to, you know, share my mobile number. Then you will receive a code. Now, first time when you give your username and password, when you give your username, it will ask you the password. When you supply the password, it will ask you to enter the PIN. So that PIN, it will dynamically generate it. If you are able to enter that PIN dynamically, then only your FB account will open. Otherwise, it never opens. Okay. We are running out of time, sir. You can just do those things. So you can just those things so that you can safeguard your information. Let's go to the PPT, main PPT. So these are the things, you know, which I told you, like what are the things I showed it to you, limited to only me or only kind of thing. By any chance, if your Facebook account was hacked, facebook.com/hack, you use that hack and so that you can put it. And in place of hack, and if you want to report, you know, for misuse of your account kind of thing, in place of hack, you can just type report, REPORT. Okay, immediately you can make a report with these people so that you can retrieve your account kind of thing. Yeah, if no problem, you can mail us, sir. No problem, you can mail us. We will try to help you out. Okay. So these are the things which are related to the social networking. Of course, like we are running out of time. I hope for all of you it is fine if I continue for another 15-20 minutes. Is it okay or you want me to stop you? Please say yes or no, sir, so that I will continue for another 15 minutes so that at least you can learn something. Is it okay? All right. Thank you. So this is another thing which is, you know, heavily it is happening. Fake information, fake quotes, fake information and all such kind of things. So you have to what is a source where it is got generated, whether it is a recent thing or it is a old thing, and who is the author, what is the date, and whether it is a biased information or it is a generic information. Is it a joke or it is a serious thing? Or is it an expert suggestion kind of thing? So whenever you receive any message, so please verify these things before you forward to anyone else. Okay, to check these things, our government of India has started, you know, PIB fact check. There is a Twitter handler. There is a something called Twitter handler by the PIB fact check. If you click on the PIB fact check, so here you will come to know lot of information. Like whether whatever the information you received, whether it is fake kind of thing, you will come to know. You will come to know whether it is a genuine information or fake information. If it is a fake information, you reply back to that fellow, says like it is a fake information, don't circulate. Okay. And the information, passing of information will be stopped at your end. So please be careful before we pass any information. In nowadays, the law enforcement agencies are very, very strong. So that is what the government of India is also asking this Facebook, Twitter and WhatsApp and all such kind of things. They also wanted to find the originator. If they find the originator, they will file a case within no time against any. So please be careful while you are forwarding any information. So this is a COVID thing, first day, 20 days and all such kind of things. So the government of India said like it is a fake news. And offer letters, they also said like it is a fake news. And government launched a version of Namaste India in a tool like this. So they said like it is a fake. And you know, there are so many such kind of fake information were spread across. So to check whether it is a fake information, right information, you have to use the PIB fact check so that you will come to know whether it is a real information or a false information kind of thing. Okay. Is it a right ATM machine? Okay, is it a right ATM machine? Can you please say yes or no? Is it a right ATM machine, sir or madam? Yes, very good, very good, very good, very good. Yes, yes, Very good. Thank you. All right. Now tell me, so which is the genuine mission? Which is the right ATM mission? Either the top one or bottom one? Which is the right ATM mission? Top one or bottom one? Please say top or bottom. Top. Very good. Very good. Okay. So earlier I shown this ATM mission. Okay. Now the same mission is shown here. So the bottom mission is a fraudulent where a skimmer is attached. Where a skimmer is attached. So they will try to get all your details like your bank card number, expiry date, and all such kind of things. They will try to get your things and they also try to capture the PIN kind of thing. All right. So you have to be very careful whether before you inserting the card, whether it is a blinking or not, or like any other things are there, a kind of thing. You can just check it always, no problem. You can just check it and after that you can insert your card. All right. You can just see in the right side topmost corner, there is a skimmer. So that will capture your information. That will capture your information. All right. So if you capture that information, there are always chances that they can make a cloned, you know, you can just go, okay, the card was there, they have cloned the card and they're also capturing the PIN, you know, what are the small camera they have arranged, they're capturing the PIN, they're cloning the entire card and you may lose the money. Okay, so someone is asking like, what is the contactless card? Yes, you can use the contactless card, sir. But before using that contactless card, you can set your limit. You can go to the bank website. All right, you might be having an online account and you might be having the credit card, debit card. You can go to your bank account and there you can go to the card. And if you want to enable that contactless, or if you want to disable, you can disable it. So those options are given recently. Nowadays, RBI has given a clear instructions to all the banks and the banks are also enabled all these options. Okay, banks are also enabled all these options. You can set your limits, how much credit limit you want. See, you might be having a credit limit of 4 lakhs, 5 lakhs rupees. You can set your limits. You can disable all your transaction, maximum 5,000 rupees at POS and a point of sale. You can just do a transaction up to 10,000 rupees. Whenever you are doing more transactions, you can always, you know, change those. You can always change those limits. Okay. Of course, like they have giving, and at the same time, they're also giving all these options. They're also giving all these options to set your things. Okay. So these are the skimmers you can just see. So these are the skimmers which they will try to capture all your information, including your number, you know, CVV. Whatnot, all that information you can capture by using a simple cloning machine, simple skimmer. Okay, so this is how the data goes. So please be careful while when you are entering, you have to do all such kind of things. Okay, so another thing, we are using card, debit card details, in e-commerce platforms or in a tag forms or in a online platform. What we suggest to you, before you perform the transaction, enter your details. Once the transaction you have completed, you should remove all the payment details by using your payment methods. You can go to the settings, you can go to the payment method, and you can remove the credit card, debit card details which are there as part of your e-commerce website or e-commerce mobile application. Why are we saying like that? For example, if you are using any credit card, debit card, details are saved. And the moment you come back to your home, you will keep your phone aside. You will take rest, or our children will start using that. Our children using that. By any chance, if they are playing any games kind of thing, after 3 to 4 steps, it may ask you, to pay some money. So before we go further, so that time, without your knowledge, they will deduct the money. Without your knowledge, they will deduct the money. How they will deduct? You may be without giving the CVV, without giving the expiry date, without giving the PAN. How the money will be deducted? The money will be deducted RAM, say. whenever you are doing domestic, then only you require all these details. Whenever you are doing any international transactions, they don't want your CVV, they don't want your OTP and all such kind of things. International transactions are not required. For international transactions, only the card number is sufficient. So that is how people are losing the money. If at all, if you are playing online games kind of thing, you have to be more careful, especially when you are using the same mobile phone for your online gaming and financial transactions and all that things. So that is only the reason we are suggesting don't keep any payment method details in any of your applications. Once the transaction is over, kindly remove all the payment methods from that mobile application. Okay, so if you follow that, at least you can safeguard your hard-earned money. So this is only a preventive measure. All right. So if your phone is secure and if you are confident enough and if you are doing everything, then no issues. Okay, that is up to you. So this is only a suggestion which we are trying to provide you. So as we are keep on telling you from morning onwards, whenever you are doing any financial transactions, please be check whether the HTTPS is there or not, lock symbol is there or not. If you click on that lock symbol, you will be getting the digital certificate. Morning, you have seen this digital certificate, whether the validity is there or not. For example, we are just mentioning here, Bank of India. The application is available by DCET, and they have given the digital certificate 2022. Okay, till next year, they have given a digital certificate. So till that time, so these people will take care. Those people are giving some kind of assurance, says that this application is verified by us and we are giving the digital certificate. It is a secure, safe and secure. We have quality assurance and quality checking, So once before we move to the next level, someone will verify that and say that, yes, we can go ahead kind of thing. Similarly, these people are also giving the certificates. So these kind of certificates we have to check for you. Your username and password for any online transaction. In fact, after checking these three things only, you should provide your username and password. Otherwise, on HTTPS sites, if you are sharing on HTTPS sites, there are chances that other people can see your username and password. Like you have seen the phishing attack. So that is HTTP. That is, there is no H. So people can see your details. So please be careful while you are doing any of these transactions. Okay, online shopping, I just mentioned our online shopping is preferable. You all can do it, but the thing is, like once the transaction is over, you can remove all your payment methods from that application. Okay, I hope I'm clear, and it might be useful to some of you. Please say yes sir. Please say yes or no. Okay, thank you. Good. All right. So, yes, definitely. Thank you. So, I'm taking you to my website, infosecawareness.in. So, this is my website. This is my, this is from sites. Yes, we should remove payment methods, sir. Don't keep any of your payment methods on any of the websites as well as any of the online websites. Okay. So please come to this infosecawareness.in. The moment you type this infosecawareness.in, you will be getting this security pledge. Anyone can do that. If you're a student, you can do this. And if you can just click here and you can complete your security pledge so that you can download your certificate. I told you, we are giving you this 2 hours. Or in practices course. So if it is 2 hour cyber practices course, you will come to know all these things. Generic online training, government officials for government of India. This is a generic online training in security. Okay. So this course is having 3 modules. Just click on login. It's a no problem. If you're a first user, you have to register yourself and you can ask, like whatever you have listened from morning to evening, 4 different sessions. This will be useful. Beyond that, we also learn things by our own. Okay, this content is available in English and Hindi. You can learn. if you are having a username and password, you can log in or click here, register here. You just click on the register here so that it will ask you some of the basic details. You can just provide your basic details. Okay, you can just provide your basic details and you can access this course. Okay, this link, we will send it along with you, along with the assessment link. Okay, this I request and I also suggest to all of you, you complete this course. You also suggest this course to all your neighbors, with your family members, for friends and everyone can do this course, which is the online platform. They can learn something at least, and they can safeguard by themselves in the digital platform. Okay. So with that, I end my session. With this, I'm going to close my session. So this is the e-learning course, which you all can perform. Was the remainings, as I mentioned to you. So that was the 4-hour course, and this is the e-learning course. Whoever completes, you will be getting that certificate. Okay, so that's one thing. And by tomorrow morning, we are going to share you the assessment link. By tomorrow morning, we are assessment link. In that assessment link, you will be getting one link wherein you can give your feedback over there, and you can download your certificate. You can give your feedback. You can download your certificate. That is one thing. And tomorrow we are also going to share the Cyber Hygiene Practices course link. You can just go through that Cyber Hygiene Practices course, and you also can, you download your certificate. And we are also going to share you our Telegram link. You can join so that every day in this security links. And we have also developed one mobile application on Cyber Hygiene Practices. We have developed one mobile application on Cyber Practices. You all can download Hygiene Practices mobile application from your Play Store, and you on mobile also you can complete this course. Okay, and on mobile, do a workshop. Such kind of alerts you will alerts and register, and you enhance your capabilities. Okay, with that, I conclude here. If you have any questions, kindly keep it in the chat area. I'm going to answer all your questions right now. Okay, sir, how to get the payment method from the websites? You can just go to login, sir, and there you can just click the settings. If you go to the settings, and then you will get payment methods. If you click on the payment method, you can delete that payment method. You can just see how the payment method can be deleted, and accordingly you can just see that. Otherwise, the process. Today's webinar we will share you, sir. Tomorrow we will share you that YouTube link also. Or like you can just go to ISEA. Okay, you open the YouTube, you type ISEA, and you will be getting ISEA YouTube channel, and you will be getting ISEA YouTube channel. You will be getting ISEA YouTube, so that you can see all our videos, all our session videos. You can just see ISEA a YouTube channel. You can go and type ISEA and ISEA, and you will be getting all the videos which we have organized in recent times. Kindly share the YouTube link. Okay, that is the answer. Kindly share the YouTube link. Can you provide the study material? Yes, you can download in the InfoSec awareness. You are having all such kind of things, sir. You can download those materials and you can use it. Very essential type of training is very essential for government staff, especially for the IT IP. Myself being of the network in the East Coast, please suggest. Yesterday we got a request. We are trying to foundation courses, 5-day foundation courses. You will learn more and more things. Okay, we will let you know. And if you are interested, you can approach your CISOs, so that those CISOs will come back to us, and we can organize this kind of training programs to all these people. All the details are shared in the registered email. Okay, I will be getting the link tomorrow to share the link, sir. And where can we get study material? Sir, I told you can go to my website. Okay, InfoSec awareness.in. You can just go to this website. Okay, you can just go to the website and you can just come back. There's something called handbooks. This thing on the handbooks, there are so many handbooks which are mainly for these government users, which are mainly for these people like who have attended our sessions. You can further build your things. See, you can see all the books. Okay, cyber safety and security book. You can download crimes and all such kind of things. There are so many books. Okay, 4 pages are there. You can just go to any of the page and you can download what you want. See, information security awareness. There are so many books. Okay, you can just see online safety tips for children, secure remote desktop access, information security awareness. And if you are a woman, online safety tips for women, working women. So all these books are there. You can download all your books and you can make use of the things as per your, as per you. And you also can download our cyber IT practice app so that you will get all such kind of information. All right, it's about, okay, what is this, sir? Please organize the short term courses. Yes, we are going to organize, sir, the courses. Thank you, Subhash Chandra Babu, for your wonderful words. And about civil layers, internet security, step security wise. Like you can just go to our YouTube channel, sir. There we have a YouTube channel. We have all these 7 network layers. What layer, what happen? All such kind of things are discussed. And in future, we will discuss all such kind of sessions. InfoSec Awareness is the website. Yes, Sugata Bhattacharya, that is the website which I'm talking about. You can just see. It includes PKI, i.e. signature, digital certificate. This is a basic awareness session, sir. So whenever we do in the next level courses, we will talk about all these PKI, SSL, and all that. We will like to provide more and more information in our future sessions. Okay. So of course, like, so I thank you, Pavi. Thank you, on behalf of ACA, for all the officers who have patiently, listening from morning to evening, and we hope you all gain something. You know, at least like when you are attending from morning to evening, you might have been gained a good amount of information. So try to implement that information as part of your personal life or your professional life. Okay, all right. Guru Shankar, thank you, sir. Guru Shankar, thank you very much. So with that, like, we thank all the officers who have patiently listening from morning to evening. And we will catch you up if the time permits, sometime we will catch you up. All right. Thank you so much, all of you. And please take care of yourself in this pandemic. Thank you, all of you. So with this, like, we are going to conclude and we are going to close the platform.